Back in the 1950s, the sports car was a simple thing. A basic two-seater with few creature comforts, skinny tyres, and a pretty little body shaped more for style than aerodynamics. But nowadays, few are prepared to put up with the discomfort of such machines. But is it possible to have what for some is the best of both worlds? 50s styling and 90s refinement? Well, Quentin thinks it is, with this car, the HMC.
Let's get something straight from the start. This is not an Austin Healey 3000, however much your eyes tell you that it is. This is an HMC Mark IV, and despite those 60s looks, it's brand spanking new.
But let's get something else straight. This is not a cheap car. A top spec HMC would set you back the greater part of £40,000, for which you could also have three Mazda MX-5s, two MGFs, and the very best Austin Healey in the world.
I've got you under my skin.
So you might say that this car doesn't make sense. How can it possibly justify such a massive price tag? And anyway, if you want a classic, buy a classic. If you want a modern, buy a modern. This is neither one nor t'other.
I've got you.
But what the HMC offers is the best of both worlds, a marriage of swooping English curves and turnkey reliability. For the enthusiast who doesn't want to tinker, who wants to enjoy his ragtop come rain or shine.
To be frank, I was determined to hate this car because it's a replica and replicas smack of kit cars, and kit cars are awfully sad, sorry things with bodies like plastic bars. But this is not a kit car. All that bright work is stainless steel. This delicious body is fiberglass, yet there's not a wave or a ripple anywhere. Listen to this. It even sounds like steel. No Austin Healey was ever this well built. And specialist sports car manufacturers like Lotus and TVR should take a long, hard look at the HMC to see how it really should be done.
And any lingering doubts I might have had about its abilities evaporated with the first dab of that throttle.
As soon as you drive this, you realize it's a great sports car in its own right, and certainly no compromise. The body control is amazing. There's no scuttle shake, no bump thump. We are going down a country road. The throttle response is instantaneous. There's this huge wall of torque. Whatever you do, if you come across one of these pottering along, don't think it's just another old Austin Healey. Don't try to take it on, because it is the dog's twitcher. It is seriously quick, and it will make you feel very, very silly indeed.
That's everything, the mere idea of you.
So how does the HMC fare nose to nose with the real thing? It's narrow versus wide, ancient versus modern. Cast iron straight six versus aluminium 3.9 V8. Steel versus glass fiber. At the wheel, these are both legs straight, arms bent macho machines. The real Healey can crack 120, but the HMC can muster 140 miles an hour and scream to 60 in less than 6 seconds. But neither of these two are about top speed.
Now, the real thing is lovely. It's charming. But despite all that originality and all that classicism, it's not nearly as quick, as safe, as solid, as secure. It is, after all, a 40-year-old design. If you want fun, if you want big, fast fun, this isn't the car to have it in.
This, on the other hand, most definitely is. If you don't have 40 grand, you can buy the lightweight for 26,000. But what do I really think? Well, my biggest gripe is that it looks too like an Austin Healey. If it had its own distinctive body shape, it would be chewing the coattails of TVRs. But to criticize a car for looking this good has to be praise indeed.
The moments go till I'm near.
Now, if you ask me, over £40,000 for this HMC is an awful lot of money to pay for a car based on the way things used to be. And there's a whole range of young bucks out there on the sports car scene ready to prove the benefits of youthful exuberance over heritage. Jeremy took 8 of the sexiest new sports cars to Scarborough to answer one simple question.
They're all fantastic, but which one's best?
First to go is the Alfa Romeo Spider. It's one of the most glorious looking cars of all time, and it has an engine to wake the dead. But to be brutal, the Alfa isn't all that nice to drive, and a sports car that isn't nice to drive is like a supermodel who's a bit ugly. But onwards now with my machete to the 1.9-litre BMW Z3, Bond's biggest mistake. This is all very reasonable stuff. Indeed, I described the Z3 last year as a great all-rounder. But that's where it falls down.
You can live with it every day, in the same way that you can live on Brown Windsor soup. It's just that there are more exciting alternatives. And according to dear old Tiff, the six-cylinder Z3 is no better. So the BMW has gone, and now it's time, shock horror, to lose the mighty Mercedes-Benz SLK. And not just because there's a 2-year waiting list.
The figures, especially the bit about superchargers, all look quite good. And that hood is a masterpiece. Whether it's up or down, the SLK is as handsome as the Alfa. It's not bad value either, especially when you remember it's hewn from solid granite. As a car, it's hard to fault, but as a sports car, it's too soft and too uninspiring. An accusation that cannot be levelled at the Renault Sport Spider. A bit of Gaelic free-fall free-thought has produced something aesthetically sensational. It was originally launched with no windscreen, but for the British market they've come over all vegan and given the driver some protection from the wind and the bees.
For a mile-long thrash to the pub, this car is outrageously good. But it needs to be warm because there's no heater.
There's also no roof, no boot, and according to Tiff, it doesn't even handle terribly well when you get near the limit.
The Renault Spider is like an elephant. I love looking at it, but I wouldn't want to own one that much. It's the other way round, with the Porsche Boxster.
That's the base price. A spec'd version is nearer £37,000. Still, Tiff and I are in full agreement on this car. It's almost unbelievably nice to drive. There's a fluidity to its handling responses. See what I mean? And a bark to the exhaust note, which lets you know it's a thoroughbred engine in a thoroughbred car. The road holding is superb, plus of course being German, it's beautifully made. Three problems boot the Porsche into touch though. It's, dare I say this, too slow, it's too expensive, and it's not pretty enough. I was expecting it to be a Bloody Mary, but someone forgot the Worcester sauce. And the vodka.
By being utterly ruthless, five excellent cars are now out of the frame, and we're left with three that are even better than excellent. The TVR Chimera, the little Lotus Elise, and the MGF VVC. Only one thing is for sure, the winner is going to be British.
It is not, however, going to be the Lotus. It has a small engine and a smallish price, but I want to make it plain that if you're an enthusiastic, skillful driver, no car made today, not even a Ferrari, rewards quite like an Elise. I was very, very tempted to make this the winner, but the hood is a terrible fiddle and there are no carpets. That's very Conran for 10 minutes, but after a while it becomes plain loud. For fun, the Elise scores 100%, but as a practical proposition, it's C+ at best.
So, what about the TVR Chimera? Mr. Noisy. Oh, you love it? It has a very definite image. Fuller's ESB, Twickenham, TVR, they go together. And it's very, very fast and very, very good looking. But I know too many people who've had too many problems with them. Just sitting here makes me feel hirsute and macho, but would I be man enough to spend all that money on a car which I feel sure would break down all the time? But I do know this, we've only got one car left. This car is not manly. It's so feminine, really, it should have wings. Plus, the dash is too plasticky and these seats are too high up. You feel like you're sitting on it, rather than in it.
It's also noisy, but overall, it's a practical everyday car.
The good news is, though, while it can sew and cook and darn socks, it also wants to stay up till 3 o'clock every morning, partying.
With a 0-60 time of 7 seconds, it's one of the faster cars here. And with its engine in the middle, it handles like a dream. This car is big fun. But don't worry, I haven't gone mad. I've decided I could take that chance with the TVR. Beauty must give way to the beast. If you're looking for a second car, something for the weekend perhaps, this is as good as it gets. I can fit in it easily, the heater works, the roof is largely vandal-proof. If it doesn't break down, it is practical.
But most of all, and thanks mainly to its blood and thunder soundtrack, this car is about as much fun as you can handle without your trousers exploding.